A warm welcome to the Indo News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the list of news articles that is chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page numbers of different editions. Also, the link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. So now let us move on to the analysis of the first news article. Now look at this news article. Based on a recent study, it has been found that vulture populations are on a rise in the tiger reserves that are located in Tamil Nadu. So in this context, let us know about vultures. See, there are 9 recorded species of vultures in India, and these 9 species includes the Oriental white-backed, long-billed, slender-billed, Himalayan, red-headed, Egyptian, bearded, Cinereus, and the Eurasian griffon. Of the recorded species, the Oriental white-backed, long-billed, red-headed vultures and slender-billed vultures are critically endangered, whereas the Egyptian vulture is listed as endangered, while the Himalayan, bearded and Cinereus vultures are near threatened. Know that in our country, the protection status of white-backed, long-billed and slender-billed vultures was recently upgraded from Scheduled 4 to Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So in this regard, let us quickly understand the significance of this particular move. See, Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act covers endangered species that need rigorous protection, and these species are endowed protection from poaching, killing, trading, etc. And a person who indulges in these activities is liable to the harshest punishment under this particular schedule. See, these species under this schedule are prohibited to be hunted throughout India except under threat to human life or in case of a disease that is beyond recovery. Whereas those species that are not endangered are included under Schedule 3 and Schedule 4 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, and this includes protected species with hunting prohibited, but the penalty for any violation is less when compared to the first two schedules. So with this, we can understand that the vultures are better protected under this act. Note that the information on the protection status of the listed vultures is given below, so aspirants can go through it. Now coming back, see, earlier former environment minister in a written reply to a parliament had said that the vulture population has declined over 99% compared to the 1980s trend. See, apparently in the 1980s there were around 40 million vultures in India, primarily belonging to the 3 species, which includes the white-backed vulture, long-billed vulture and slender-billed vulture. And if you see, as of 2017, this number has dwindled to a paltry of 19,000. So let us now try to understand the reasons for this shocking decline. See, there is a medicine called diclofenac sodium. It is a commonly prescribed medicine for pain and fever for us. This particular medicine belongs to a class of drug called non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medicines, or NSAIDs in short. And this particular drug is given to a cattle for postpartum pain management. So what happens is, when the cattle passes away, this particular drug remains in the system of the cattle. Now our vultures who feed on dead, they happen to eat on the cattle also. So this means that they also ingest diclofenac. See, in vultures, this diclofenac sodium drug, it leads to renal failure and eventually the vultures die. So this is one of the leading threat to vultures, and apart from this, there are also other threats like power distribution lines. And if you remember, the power lines were also threatening the population of Great Indian Bustard, which is another critically endangered species. Now, apart from this diclofenac drug and power distribution, the poison baits, windmills are also threatening the population of vultures in India. Now, taking cognizance of that grave situation, India has taken various steps to recover the vultures from the brink of extinction. So in order to conserve the remaining population of vultures in the country and also to facilitate the reintroduction of vultures into the wild from the vulture conservation breeding centers. And apart from this, there were attempts made to create vulture safe zones as well. So on those lines, so far 8 identified vulture safe zones in the country are being made across India, and in the year 2006, a national action working plan on vulture conservation was set in motion as well. Now, besides this, restriction on the use of diclofenac have also been made, and the government has banned the veterinary use of the drug diclofenac, which is the cause of vulture mortality. And for human consumption, the packaging size of the human formulation of the diclofenac drug has also been restricted to 3 ml in July 2015 because the multi-dose vials available in 30 ml for human consumption was misused and was being given to livestock. Adding to all this, the Environment Ministry has reconstituted the National Vulture Recovery Committee in order to oversee and guide vulture conservation and also the recovery efforts. And apart from this, the species has also been identified under the Development of Wildlife Habitat Program. And for your additional information, refresh that. The day before yesterday, we saw that even the Great Indian Bustard was also identified under this. That is, identified under the Development of Wildlife Habitat Program. So with this, we have come to the end of this particular news discussion. With these informations in mind, let us now move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article. See, this article is regarding the Rudreshwara temple, which is also known as the Ramappa temple, which is situated at Palampet in the Mulugu district of Telangana. See, India's nomination for this temple has been inscribed on UNESCO's World Heritage List, and know that this temple was proposed by the government as its only nomination for the UNESCO World Heritage Site tag for the year 2019, and the decision was taken at the 44th session of the World Heritage Committee of UNESCO. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the Ramappa temple and also its significance. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. See, we all know about the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, or UNESCO. This particular organization, it seeks to encourage the identification, protection and preservation of cultural and natural heritage around the world, which are considered to be of outstanding value to humanity. And this is embodied in an international treaty called the Convention Concerning the Protection of the World Cultural and Natural Heritage, and it was adopted by the UNESCO in the year 1972. Now, let us see the aims of this UNESCO's World Heritage Mission. See, it encourages countries to sign the World Heritage Convention and to ensure the protection of their natural and cultural heritage. And apart from this, it also encourages state parties to the convention to nominate sites within their national territory for inclusion on the World Heritage List. See, UNESCO also provides emergency assistance for World Heritage Sites in immediate danger, and apart from this, it encourages participation of the local population in the preservation of their culture and natural heritage. So having done with a brief understanding about UNESCO, now let us move on to discuss in detail about the Kakatiya Rudreshwara Temple, which is a 13th century temple that was named after its architect Ramappa. Remember, it's probably the only temple in the country to be known by the name of its sculptor. You can have a look at this great engineering marvel. See, the Rudreshwara temple was constructed in the 1213 AD, and it was built under the patronage of the Kakatiya ruler Kakati Ganapati Deva under the authority of his chief commander Recharla Rudra. Now, the presiding deity of this temple is Ramalingeshwara Swami, who is a form of Lord Shiva. And as we said, the temple is also known as the Ramappa temple, which is named after the sculptor who executed the work in the temple for 40 years. See, Warangal in the Deccan Plateau is the home to the very classic and brilliant Kakatiya hut, and the temple complexes of Kakatiyas have a very distinct style, technology and decoration, exhibiting the influence of the Kakatiyan sculptor. And the Ramappa temple is a manifestation of these attributes, and it often stands as a testimonial to the Kakatiyan creative genius. Note that the temple stands on a 6 feet high star-shaped platform with walls, pillars and ceilings, and they are adorned with intricate carvings that attest to the unique skill of the Kakatiyan sculptors. And the sculptural art and the decoration specific to the time and Kakatiyan Empire have an outstanding universal value. Know that the temple's chamber is crowned with a shikaram and it is surrounded by the Pradakshina Pada. And at the entrance of the temple, we can find a Nandi Mandapam and an imposing Nandi Vigraham stands on it. And apart from this, another striking feature of this temple is that it is built with bricks that are so light that they can easily float on water. See, the distinct style of Kakatiyas for the gateways to temple complexes is unique only to this region, and this confirms the highly evolved proportions of aesthetics in temple and town gateways in South India. And it is said that the European merchants and travelers were mesmerized by the beauty of this particular temple, and they even remarked that the temple was the brightest star in the galaxy of medieval temples of the Deccan. So with this, we have come to the end of this news discussion. Now let us move on to the next part of our Indo news analysis. Now look at this news article. This article is regarding a recent order of the Delhi High Court on overseas citizenship of India. The High Court said that foreigners, Regional Registration Office or the FRRO, cannot insist on the physical or virtual presence of both the spouses for processing OCI card for one of them. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the overseas citizens of India, and we will also look into the details on the persons of Indian origin. Know that the people who go and live abroad from India are categorized into three broad categories, such as NRIs, PIOs and OCIs. Now NRIs or non-resident Indians indicate Indians who live in another country, but PIOs or OCIs, that is persons of Indian origin and overseas citizens of India, are people who want to stay connected and to be involved with India more on a more closer basis. Now coming to the Overseas Citizenship of India scheme, so it was introduced in the year 2005 by the Government of India by amending the Citizenship Act of 1955. Now this scheme provides for registration of both the persons of Indian origin as well as the overseas citizens of India who are subjected to certain conditions. See, a person of Indian origin is a person who was an Indian national or whose any of the ancestors was an Indian national and who is presently holding another country's citizenship or nationality. See, as of 2015, all PIO card holders with a valid PIO cards as on 9th January 2015 were advised to apply for conversion of the PIO card into OCI card. And at present, the Bureau of Immigration will accept this PIO cards as valid travel document till 31st December 2021 along with their valid foreign passport. Now coming to OCI, see, it does not confer political rights for its holders. That is, they have not been given any voting rights or election to Lok Sabha or Legislative Assembly, etc. Similarly, OCI cardholder cannot hold constitutional posts such as President, Vice President, etc. Having known that, let us now see as to what is the eligibility criteria for a person to register as an OCI cardholder. See, a person who was a citizen of India or who was eligible to become a citizen of India at the time of or any time after the commencement of the constitution is eligible for this OCI cards. And next, a person who belonged to a territory that became a part of India after 15th August 1947 or after India's independence is eligible. And then a person who is a minor child or a grandchild or even a great grandchild of such a citizen mentioned above is also eligible. Here, carefully note that a person who is or had been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh is not eligible to register as an OCI cardholder. And apart from this, know that an OCI cardholder enjoys certain benefits, that is, they can visit India without visa for lifelong, and they will have multiple entry lifelong visa for visiting India for any purpose. But they require a special permission to undertake research work in India. And apart from this, another benefit is the exemption from registration with Foreigners Regional Registration Office or the FRRO for any length of stay in India. So with these details in mind, let us now move on to see what the next news article has got to tell us. Now look at this news article. This article is regarding the flood warning alert in Godavari River. And with the alert, the State Disaster Response Force, the police and other authorities are geared up for the flood mitigation exercise. So in this context, let us discuss in detail about River Godavari and its tributaries from prelims perspective. See, the Godavari River is the largest river in peninsular India and it is known as the Dakshina Ganga. See, the Godavari basin is the second largest basin after the Ganga basin and it accounts for nearly 9.50% of the total geographical area of the country. You can have a look at the Godavari river system. Know that the Godavari rises in the Sahyadris at an altitude of 1067 meter above mean sea level near Trimbakeshwar in Maharashtra. And from there, it then flows across the Deccan Plateau from the western to the eastern Ghats in a generally southeast direction and it falls into the Bay of Bengal. See, at Dhauleshwaram in Andhra Pradesh, the river divides into two branches, namely the Gautami and Vashishta. And between the two branches lies the Godavari Central Delta and the catchment area of the river is spread in the states of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Orissa and Karnataka. Now coming to the boundaries of the river, see the Western Ghats form a continuous watershed on the west and on the north the basin is bounded by the Satmala Hills, the Ajanta Range and the Mahadevu Hills. And the basin is bounded on the east by the Eastern Ghats and the Bay of Bengal and on the south it is bound by the Balaghat and the Mahadevu Ranges and also the Anantgiri Hills. So having done with these informations, finally let us see the tributaries of Godavari. See, the largest tributary of Godavari is the Pranitha with about 34.87% coverage of drainage area. The Pravara, Manjira and Manar are the right bank tributaries covering about 16% and the Purna, Pranitha and Indravati and also the Sabari are the important left bank tributaries which covers nearly 59.7% of the total catchment area of the basin. You can have a look at the important tributaries of Godavari from the image given below. So with this we have come to the end of this news discussion. So these are some of the important points that we need to keep in mind when it comes to the Godavari river. So with this let's move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article. It is about two contentious areas in the China-India standoff. Militarily speaking, it is an interesting area of discussion. So now let us move in to the article to understand it better. See, patrolling point 15 or PP-15 in Hot Springs and patrolling point 17A near Gogra Post are two areas of contention in Ladakh. See, in May 2020, China had diverted its troops towards a line of actual control in eastern Ladakh, creating a standoff with India. And in that, PP-15 and PP-17A were two of the four points where the soldiers were eyeball to eyeball. So what is this PP-15 and PP-17A? See, along the line of actual control between India and China, Indian Army has been given certain locations that our troops have to control. So this means that these areas are under its control and these points are known as patrolling points or PPs and usually they are decided by this China study group. See, this China study group is an Indian organ which was set up in the year 1976 when Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister. See, this is the apex decision making body on China and mostly these patrolling points are on the LAC or the line of actual control and troops access these points to assert their control over the territory. See, note that this is an important exercise because the boundary between India and China is not yet officially demarcated. Now coming back, PP-15 and PP-17A are two of the 65 patrolling points in Ladakh along the line of actual control and this PP-15 is located in an area known as the Hot Springs, whereas PP-17A is located near an area called the Gogra Post. So what are these two areas? Please look at the map in order to understand this better. See, both of these are close to the Chang Chenmo River in the line of actual control in the eastern Ladakh. And this hot spring is just north of the Chang Chenmo River. And this Gogra post lies to the east of the point where the river takes a hairpin bend. And the area is north of the Karakoram range of mountains, which lies north of the Pangong So Lake and southeast of Galwan Valley. So you may wonder, why are these regions important? See, hot springs and Gogra post are close to the boundary between two of the most historically disturbed provinces of China. Note that both PP-15 and PP-17A are in an area where India and China largely agree on the alignment of the LAC, which comes southeast from Galwan Valley, turns down at Gongala and moves towards Anpas before reaching the north bank of Pangong So. And China has got a major post of the People's Liberation Army a few kilometers east of Gongala, while Indian post lies southwest of it. But the history notes that Hot Springs was an important post even during the 1962 conflict, and in October 1962 there was a company strength at the Galwan post, while three other posts, namely Hot Springs, Nala Junction and Patrol Base, had strengths of a platoon. See, Hot Spring also served as the company headquarters and was shelled by the Chinese on October 21st. And the Chinese troops had wanted to get behind Hot Spring but were resisted at the Nala Junction. And this is the reason why these are important areas of military intentions. So having done with the article discussion for today, let us now move on to the next segment of our Indo News analysis, that is the prelims practice question discussion. Now look at this question. With reference to the Rudreshwara temple or Ramappa temple in Telangana, consider the following statements. Statement 1 says that it was built by Sri Krishna Devaraya of the Vijayanagara Empire. Statement 2 says that it is inscribed on UNESCO's World Heritage List. And statement 3 says that it is known as the brightest star in the galaxy of medieval temples of the Deccan. And we need to find only the correct answer. See, when you look at the three options itself, we can find that statement 1 is incorrect because it was built under the patronage of the Kakatiya ruler, Kakati Ganapati Deva, and not by Sri Krishna Devaraya of the Vijayanagara Empire. So, this means that the first statement is incorrect. And based on our discussion, we can infer that statement 2 and statement 3 are right. So since we need to find only the right statements, the correct answer here is option D, that is 2 and 3 only. Now look at this prelims practice question. Which of the above is or are the benefits enjoyed by an overseas citizen of India cardholder? See, first of all, the benefits enjoyed by an overseas citizen of India are multi-purpose, multiple entry, lifelong visa for visiting India, and then exemption from registration with local police authority for any length of stay in India, and then is a parity with the NRIs in respect of economic, financial and educational fields, except in matters relating to the acquisition of agricultural and plantation properties. So when viewed in this context, we can find that statement 1 and 2 that are given here are correct, but and statement 3 is incorrect. Now see, this statement 3 is incorrect because as we saw, OCI are treated in parity with NRIs only in respect to matters related to economic, financial and educational fields, and not in matters relating to the acquisition of agricultural or plantation properties. And since the question wants us to find only the right statement, the right answer here is option A, that is 1 and 2 only. Now let us take up this question on vultures. Which of the following are critically endangered species of vultures in India? And they have given 5 species here. So as we saw in the discussion, there are 9 recorded species of vultures in India. And among these 9 species, the oriental white-backed, long-billed, red-headed vultures and slender-billed vultures are critically endangered. So when viewed in this context, we can infer that option D is the right answer because Himalayan vulture is listed as near threatened and not as critically endangered. So therefore the right answer here is option D, that is 1, 2, 3 and 5. Now look at this question. Consider the following rivers. Which of the above are the tributaries of river Godavari? So based on our discussion, we can easily infer that the right option here is option C, that is 2, 3 and 4 only. Now the first option, that is Sionath, is incorrect because it is a tributary of Mahanadi and not a tributary of Godavari. So the right answer is option C, that is 2, 3 and 4 only. Now let's take this question. PP15 and PP17A recently seen in news is associated with which of the following? The right answer here is option C, that is petrol points at LAC. So with this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. If you like the video, then don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.